further ado, I will want to introduce one of the most fabulous men on the planet that you will have the pleasure to listen to today. My love, Mr.
My first instruction is always get someone who loves you unconditionally to be your partner. I love a full room!
Yeah!
We took down a couple more chairs so there'd be standing room open?
No, there.
Love being back in New York. We're very proud of the New York Temple, which has been going on for how many years now? So basically, planted the seeds about 7 years ago, and the temple's a couple years younger than that. There's a pronounced, and then there's a temple. It's a vibrant, strong group. We're proud of the teachings. If we have time, I will tell you about the Hierophant project at the end, but I don't want to derail what I actually had planned today, so you can we can come back to that. Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law.
Love is the law. Love is your will.
And because of what I said, the first word of the law is do. That one gets missed. Today's talk is about putting the do back and do what thou wilt. I want to talk about basically two topics. I want to talk about Thelema, the doing of true will as a method, not as a result that you're aiming at down the road. I want to talk about it as the starting place and a whole method in itself. And I want to talk to you about another phrase that I'll say for when I get there, that reframes the same ideas in language that other people that don't have any special training or introduction are likely to pick up on the spot, just in casual language, and let's see where that takes us. And then some spin-offs from that. But basically, to set up for the two main things I'm going to talk about, I want to give a little introduction. I imagine most of you here are familiar with Thelema, Thelemic philosophy, the Book of the Law, and so forth. Let me give a rundown of some key points, anyway, to create a language, to lay some basics in. There are three words that share the same numerical value in the Kabbalistic form of numerology called gematria. One is the Greek word Thelema, one is the Greek word agape, and one is the Hebrew word zaba. These words mean will, love, and star. That's our three-legged stool. Will, love, and star. The Greek thelema, will, refers to the true will or the root divine impulse inherent within you. In modern Greek, the word has come to mean a bit more desire than will, and that's interesting because in most ancient languages, the words for desire and will weren't separable. They are essentially the same thing. And so will is sometimes looked at in a sterile way versus love, almost as if it's an intellectual and emotional thing. But the root idea of thelema means desire, deep, profound, from your gut, from your inner soul, out desire. Couple of phrases you're familiar with, do what thou wilt should be the whole of the law, and thou hast no right but to do thy will. I'm a big fan of the Bill of Rights, but really, you've only got one right, according to the Book of the Law, that is inherent and inalienable, and that is the right to do your will. One could argue you don't have the right to do anything else. One could argue. The Greek word agape means love and refers to the passionate love of the divine as a recognition, and the recognition that there is no separation between us. Notice how will marks us as distinctive, singular. What is your specialization within the human species? And love is based upon the idea that there is no separation, that there is connection, and both of these are fundamental to the basis of Thelema. Now, the ancient Greeks had three primary words for love. They had more than that, but really only three that got any heavy use. Cutting through academic ways of doing it, agape basically means unconditional love. The love you have for someone independent of erotic considerations or commercial considerations or, you know, deep and unconditional. You're probably most familiar with it with a different accent in the popular use by many Christians of agape. I like to put the emphasis on the last syllable because we know more about ancient Greek culture now, and I mean ancient Greek language, and the ancient Greek accent was not a stress, more technical than you need, but the length of the vowel is closer to what English is uses for an accent. Plus, by pronouncing it agape, not only lengthen the vowel but the emphasis, but it sort of distinguishes it from automatic familiar reactions to Christian terminology. In the word agape, in the word agape as they use it, which is not all that different. It sometimes carries a different moral spin. But another Greek word for love is eros. You all know that word, right? Okay. It's basically erotic love. It translates well. It's sexual, sensual love. It's the raw, non-idyllic, sometimes idyllic aspect of what we might call romantic love. And the third main word is philia. Which is the love of close friendship, of affiliation, of Philadelphia, love of brothers, basically. Come in. And these distinctions are here, and I'm primarily doing it because it's not Eros, and it's not Philia, and it's not any of the others that has that 93 key, that has that main thing. The essence of love in the Book of the Law, Crowley's interpretation, the Gematria interpretation, is speaking of agape, a profound, penetrating love that in practice is essentially bhakti. There's really no difference between agape and bhakti. Profound love for the divine. It's a foundation of intimate human connection. The Book of the Law, of course, the most famous line, love is law, love under will. What does love under will mean? You're just like making it secondary? Well, we're not called agapeists, you know, we're called thelemites. One thing love under will means is love at choice. Love is an act of choice, and love is an act of choice. For example, in comparison to merely being overwhelmed by feelings that compel you out of your control or let you deny accountability. When all those feelings are there, when all the situations are there, love and will is love at choice. It's also love in the context of will. Even if you manage to love universally, the question is, what are the connections, the associations, and so forth, that are consistent with where you're moving through your life? Where you,
Love is the context of will, or the other way around?
I was, in this case, saying will as the context of love. That's a different conversation. Yes. The Book of Law also tells us love one another with burning hearts. This is not passionate or abstract or only idyllic. The Hebrew word zaba means star. There's a story about that, I'll come back to it. It basically affirms that each of us is a spiritual being alive in a universe of unending wonder and choice. We are inherently celestial beings. We are inherently of the nature of stars. It's a metaphor. It might be literal, because our bodies are probably composed of the same stuff that composes stars. The essence of what makes us alive, existing things, is probably of the same stuff as stars. at the very least, in approaching that, it's an amazing metaphor, and many of the Thelemic metaphors we use is based upon the idea of stars in a universe of infinite space with enough room for everything and each thing as part of a connected order, each thing having its own way. And yet, you know, this is that connection between love and will. It's like you can't think of will, you can't think of choice out of the context of a larger framework. Planets moving. Yeah, planets have an orbit around the sun, right? But the gravitational pull of one will affect the other, will modify the orbit, will determine what's its natural course. Mars does, as complaining as Mars is, Mars doesn't complain when Jupiter in the same area of the sky suddenly speeds up or slows down its orbit. It basically creates, it bends space. That's what gravitation does. It bends space so that the natural course, the gutter that Mars is rotating around in four-dimensional time-space is simply something different, and it's smooth and finds its own way. All of us are will. That which makes us distinctive and unique and individual and self-governing is nonetheless in the context of a larger whole that we're not separate from. Or to loop back and say these a different way, the divine aspect corresponding to our experience in ourselves as separate, unique, and individual, we call will. And it's especially represented in the Thelemic pantheon by the idea we call Hadith, the center of every circle, the moving point of view from which we experience our journeys through existence. Sometimes Hadith is represented as a point, the center of every infinite circle. Sometimes as a serpent, as a flowing idea, and it's fascinating to me that the same year the Book of the Law was dictated, Albert Einstein got a concept that unfolded into the roots of quantum mechanics, which basically have identified that what we call a particle is either a particle or a wave, depending on what preconception you carry into looking at it. Hadith is either a point or a wave. Find that interesting. The divine aspect corresponding to our experiencing ourselves in the collective as inseparably one, we call love. We represent by the goddess Nuit, the all-embracing and womb-embracing circumference of the circle, the circumference that contains everything. Now, when you take a circumference and when you acknowledge the center of it, you actually get the astrological glyph of the sun. That's worth putting up here for a moment. And the third idea in the Book of the Law, corresponding to the god Horus, is the idea of a child that is the child of both of its parents, that is the center and the circumference at once. And the full living, the life of Horus, the life of, who also is of the nature of a pentagram or a star, is the idea of coexisting in the simultaneous awareness of being an irreplaceable, distinctive, unique point in all creation and being inseparable from, part of, and one greater organism of everything. The Hadith and Nuit perspectives, the will and love. In this case, love is the context of will. So that's a little bit of integration. Bring all these ideas together. A little summary paragraph here. We understand each person to have an inner truth of self that we call true will. An appointed path in a spacious cosmos through which we all may move without interference or conflict. It is the task and the joy of each of us to discover our true will and then to do that will with one-pointedness, detachment, peace, and joy. Here is the miracle of the Thelemic philosophy that, in my experience, turns out to be exactly true, not just a nice, this would be a great idea, wouldn't it? It's in when you find and know and own that thing which you would more deeply and fundamentally wish to do than any other thing, that thing which seems to be the whole spark of why you're alive, from which every impulse, every sense of victory, every sense of defeat and disappointment, every choice you've ever made has emerged, it happens also to be the thing you're most useful to the rest of life for. It happens to be the thing where you have your highest level of contribution possible. In other words, what you're best at is what you feel best at, to bring it into simpler terms. Discovering, you know, coming to fully know and actualize your true will is living most joyously to yourself and most contributingly to everyone. And that, my friends, is to me amazing. Even after all this time, it's to me amazing. One of the things I like in my book Visions and Voices is actually a glossary in the back. And you can read the third of the page, long, carefully thought out definition of true will in there. I want to picture in your mind, how many people here know what vector mathematics is? A few of you? Okay, here's the basic idea. Every force can be diagrammed as having a strength, a certain amount of power behind it, and a direction. Okay, a force has strength and direction. And so you can draw this as an arrow pointing in some direction, right? You can point, if I say, oh, we have a force that's going this way, and then we have a weaker one going the same way, but it's weaker, and then we have another one that's coming down this way, and maybe it's a little stronger. There are a lot of forces going, there are a lot of forces inside of us. Now, mathematicians have ways of dealing with vectors geometrically that match how things work in physics. Basically, you can add and subtract them. For example, if you have forces going in the same direction, and you have one that's this long, and one that's this long, and one that's this long, they add up. They become one big force pointing the long way. On the other hand, suppose you have two vectors pointing in opposite directions, two forces pulling against each other. One elephant on either side of me, and the rope. At this point, the limiting factor is the ability of my body to tolerate being pulled apart by two elephants. But besides that, when we have in ourselves two forces, two desires, two impulses that seem to be pointing in essentially opposite directions of comparable strength, they wipe each other out. That's like saying we have a vector that's going that way at +3, and a vector going this way at -3, that's a zero. Okay? In fact, that's a useful definition of a problem. What is a problem? I'll tell you what a problem is. You can mathematically solve it. The problem is when you have two forces of comparable magnitude and opposite direction existing in you. Okay? Now, the thing is, we're not that simple. We have lots of competing thoughts and desires and wishes, and so we have these little arrows going off in all these different directions. And I can be pulled here, I can be pulled there, my thoughts going like this, I gotta do this right now. And so we have all these little forces in all these multiple directions, and you know what? They tend to, when you add that all up, you get little bitty arrows going some direction, you know, something that outweighs itself. And the closer they are all to equal, the more you hit paralysis when people don't know how to make a choice. Do you want to bring wine? Do you want to bring cheese? I said the solution is, if you can't make up your mind, bring both. Got to get outside the duality on it. Okay, so for all this competing flood of complexities, what happens when you find one impulse that you can make the center of everything else? Suddenly, all those arrows line up pointing in more or less the same direction, and suddenly, instead of canceling each other out and paralyzing you and making you feel weaker and like you don't know what to do, and you've got plenty of strength, except you never seem to get anything done, because how in the world, anyway, you got it, is suddenly it's this one massive force flowing in one direction. All of the power in you lines up. It's as if you have all the force of the universe behind you. Because you do. All pointing in one direction. So, with, okay, by the way, when you add up all those vectors, the technical term is resultant. Okay? I mentioned that because the one part of the definition true what I want to read is, as most commonly used in the temple of Thelema, it is the resultant, you know, the vector math sum, of all the vectors, all the conditions and characteristics in your life that are expressed through the focus of one specific incarnation. You are an infinite being, but what are the conditions and characteristics that are flowing through this specific incarnation into the world? And in that sense, it's nearly synonymous with life purpose or deepest impulse of self-expression. Okay? Functionally, that's it. But I got another term that I'm stealing from an author I'll give credit to lots of other things later. My favorite definition of true will in practice is that place where our deep gladness meets the world's deep need. That place where our deep gladness meets the world's deep need. Take that, run with it, think about it, find it yourself. Purpose of Temple of Thelema, my purpose, is to assist everybody, to train all to know and to do their true wills. Essentially, you want a, you want a single mission statement? That's it. To become conscious of the deep truth of themselves, and then to live ongoingly consistent with your own truth. To become conscious of the deep truth of yourself, and to live ongoingly, consciously, aligned with that. Because, you know, like, we fight ourselves. When you know what's best for you, you always make that decision, right? No. Even after enlightenment, you always make enlightened decisions, right?
No.
Sure. So one is the process of coming to awareness of it, and the second is committing yourself to be true to yourself, basically. To conform your choices, your actions, your movements, to what you are really clear is what you're all about anyway. Right? And there are forces that compete against this. There are people who've known us for a long time and are very happy with how we've been. And so you go to the people that are closest to you, that care the most about you, and you find that they're fighting you on your growing, on your discovering something new, on your going down some new path, because all you're doing is taking who they care about away from them. Right? That's a common problem. Run into things of that sort. So, here's the thing. We're used to thinking and talking about knowing and doing your true will as basically something you attain. You know, the process and you come through this. You go through a spiritual journey. You come to the place where this is true. I'm going to talk about it as a starting place. Because I'm going to talk about it as a method. As perhaps the only method you need for all the spiritual goals. Bring you down to one stable daily. Now, there are other terms we're used to using, but sometimes the term means a method, and sometimes it means a result. Like the Sanskrit word, dharana. Dharana is the sixth step of an eight-step yoga thing. Literally means concentration. Oh, wait a minute! Concentration is like down here at step six, like it's the start of the major result. Well, concentration as a method starts at the beginning. It's like core to yoga practice, core to meditation, core to magic. The ability to place your mind in a place and keep it where you want to put it. But when you speak of dharana as a result, as the sixth limb of yoga, it means concentratedness. Your being has flowed forward and become concentrated in a particular place. So you see, the same word means a result, your concentratedness, a very advanced result, and a method. Concentrating, which is a threshold skill, a threshold practice. I'm here today to float the idea that doing your true will is the same kind of thing. Start today, start this minute, and watch it unfold just in the course of living your life itself. I want to pause and say that you occasionally find confusion of the name of another spiritual experience, knowledge, and conversation of the Holy Guardian Angel with knowing the true will. Certainly, if you haven't figured out who you are by the time you hit the high threshold of the knowledge and conversation of the Holy Guardian Angel, it will be made clear. But usually, the conscious knowing, integrated knowing of the true will comes long before that. I started saying, don't confuse the KNC or the HGA with the KND and the TW. Today we're talking about the KND and the TW, the knowing and doing your true will. At the same time, these are related phenomena, and the one can be all you need for the other. So, I understand that Liber 8 is supposed to be Crowley's instruction on crossing the abyss, but it looks like it's just like this practice on how to attain to the knowledge and conversation of the Holy Guardian Angel. Well, they didn't read paragraph 26. Whatever number it is. Basically, it is mostly a practical instruction attaining the knowledge and conversation of the Holy Guardian Angel. And then, most of the way through, it says, and after you've done this, turn it over to the angel, and the angel will take you across the abyss eventually. That's the entire instruction, right? The one is all you need to eventually be led to the other. What hasn't been said in writing, and I'm here to say today, is that the knowing and doing of your true will has the same relationship to the HGA experience. The knowing and doing of your true will is that which, if you persist in it, may be the only thing at all that you need to open you up. They are related. Basically, going from do to do, basically, when you find yourself moving in frictionless conformity with your own way through the universe without resistance, with the forces of the cosmos moving along, is it any surprise that you make contact with something deeper and more fundamental and truer and cosmic in you? It's just gonna happen. It's just gonna happen. How many people have read Crowley's long book-length poem, Aha? So you'll remember that it poses a fascinating question at the end. Aha is a poetic dialogue between a guru and a chela, between a teacher and a student. And during most of the book, the teacher is laying out all the fundamental ways. It's a remarkable description of the steps of yoga, the processes of magic, the basic kind of techniques. And it's coming to a climax, and you think it's kind of over. And they sit down and they say, let's just meditate together. And they meditate, and teacher goes off, comes back, goes, whoa, I got this new truth. And he starts explaining, in beautiful, concise, poetic language, the Book of the Law. It's got just a few pages. It kind of compresses and brings the whole thing together in wonderful language. It's some of his best poetry. And then the student's going, how's this new thing compared to like all this other stuff we've been doing and you've been teaching me? You know, I mean, which is better? Teachers just try both. Find out. And that's my word to you. Try both. Find out. The thing is, doing your true will, acting in conformity with your deepest truth, essentially with the word cosmos for you, is an act of karma yoga. It's a practice of karma yoga. And that's the whole key. Because karma yoga for millennia has been recognized as one path that is suitable for attainment in and of itself. And doing your true will is the highest form of karma yoga that I can think of. Simply recognizing that's what it is. What is karma yoga? Karma yoga is union by doing. Okay? Union by work, union by action. Let's just say union by doing. Normally described, say, by Vivekananda and others as it is union through work and through working without attachment to the results of the work. Simply pure work as an ongoing thing. Pure work, consciously done as a practice, but without attachment to the fruits of it. Planting trees that will grow for 100 years. Pure work. Of course, planting trees will grow for 100 years and getting paid for it. Good work. Doing your true will. Simply being deeply true to yourself and fulfilling what you are most suitable to give to the world is not only joyous and contributing, but is pure karma yoga. It's a very nice kind. And hey, that stuff helps you attain, right? There's a banishing and a consecrating here by doing your true will and only that. First of all, you're ruling out the things that aren't natural to you, the things that are in your way, the things that are a distraction, the things that absorb energy that you could be putting into something else. There's also consecration, because there's a dedication. There's a dedication of yourself to this truth in action, not as an abstraction, not as sitting home watching the game tonight thinking, oh, I know who I am, God knows. But taking it into action. Put the do back and do what thou wilt. Leading to this point, usually people will have been doing other karma yoga practices, I recall. I don't think you find these in the usual karma yoga book, but there are other karma yoga practices that simply tend to be part of that path of waking up to this more fully. For example, does the practice of authenticity, of being so far as you can in the moment, where you are, true to yourself in your expression, in your doing. Okay? Simply holding yourself to be true to yourself. Oh, I forgot to put this in my notes, but this is kind of really important. Does anybody here, like, hide anything of themselves from anybody? Obviously, you're not going to pull your hand out of your hands. Okay. Okay. If you're withholding yourself from everyone around you, you're withholding it from yourself. You may like know about this, or do I like to put it, we're all inclusive about something. Okay? Out of the closet, activism spreads far wider than just a couple of ethnic groups. We're all in the closet about something, you know. To the extent that you hide who you essentially are in your actions and dealings with other people, you hide it from yourself. And to the extent you come forth and bring it out and give expression to it, you are living it. You are being it. You are bringing it into action. You're putting the do back and do what that will. Look at the things that are true about you. And I'm not saying whatever your closet is, you have to come at your parents first. I'm saying that the path to being disclosed to who you essentially are in greater and greater circles of your life and your fundamental living is a profound spiritual practice. Living authentically, living openly true in your life expression to who you are. Another karma yoga practice is the using your increasing truth sense. The colloquial term for truth sense is bullshit meter. It's sort of the flip side of the coin. But as we go along in spiritual practices, in spiritual opening, we develop a deeper truth sense. You know what's true. And this comes to the extent that you're being true to yourself. To the extent that you're admitting what's true of you, you see truth. Some of you have heard this before. I'm going to tell you how to develop an extraordinary magic power. Extraordinary magic power. This is serious. I'm not joking about this at all. People will think you are scary. Okay? Truth is, almost everything there is to know about a person is out here right in front of us always. Okay? But we have a consensual decision to hide it. We have an acculturation, a way that we're raised to hide it. Okay? We buy into the game of, if you don't see what's really true about me, I won't see what's really true about you. It's not just we'll pretend that we don't, it's like, not looking! Okay? And it's a deal, it's a good trade-off. It's like, you know, what I want most is for like nobody can really know what's real about me, and you do too, so like let's be polite. It's kind of like bathroom etiquette. You know? There are things that we all know is true of ourselves and every other human being that happen in usually in one room of the house that we then go through most of our lives acting like it doesn't happen. Right? Okay? This is what we do on a much bigger picture. Thing is, this is an example of contract law, though. It takes a two-way deal. Here's the thing. If you opt out of the deal, if you're willing to be completely seen, the filters go away. If you're willing to be completely seen, the filters go away, and you see everything that everyone else doesn't see. You see things straight through to a person. But you have to be willing to be naked to see naked people. Or something like that. Okay? You have to be the little boy who says the emperor has no clothes.
And neither do I.
Yeah, nobody told you there's a naked little boy standing there, right? A lot of little naked little boys on medieval streets, right? So the when you opt out of that game, suddenly you can see pretty much everything. People will be amazed. They will be scared shitless. They will think you must work for the CIA and who in the world bugged you. But, you know, I mean, and it's pretty, but that's a true magic power. All you have to do is get out of the game. In life, you simply need to act. We need more activism in life on whatever the thing is that you have there. You need to act from yourself. You need to act enthusiastically. Enthusiasm is the elixir of life. You don't need to worry about all the chemical mixtures and how do you do those body fluids together. No, it's the enthusiasm that you bring to that. Enthusiasm is the elixir of life. It is life itself in a fluidic fashion. So you need to act from yourself. You need to act enthusiastically. You need to act authentically. You need to bring what you have out as if, at any moment, the whole world is ready to drink deeply from everything pouring through you. We'll talk about what happens when you see the hit the wall in a bit. I'm a strong believer in the principle, when in doubt, do something. It tends to be a cultural habit of, when in doubt, wait until you're not in doubt. Okay? That tends to be the reason a lot of stuff doesn't get done that could get done in the world. So just dive in. What happens if you miss the mark? That's called enrolling in school. If you miss the mark and go, oh, I wasn't supposed to leap off that one, you'll learn. You're immortal. Okay? Now, I'm not saying run out in front of a Mack truck to find out what it is. That will give you a larger scale view on things. It probably won't help you enter an incarnation. But in general, put the pedal to the metal and like just go for it. dive out there. Life will edit you. I am certain I have never learned anything important other than by screwing up. I am certain I have never, I've memorized facts and things like that. I am certain I have never learned anything fundamentally important in my life except by screwing up. That's the education process. What happens when you fail? You get to take the class over again. And you'll get it right. And you'll have more help this time. If you miss the mark, you will learn as you spiral down the drain a bit. But if you're enthusiastic and authentic to yourself and coming from what's your best truth at the moment, eventually what you're spiraling down is into the center of yourself, the stellar splendor, the very fiery heart of your creative celestial self, and it will feel true. And it will be true. About reaching the center, we're used to thinking, we're used to thinking of the metaphor that from the circumference, every point of the circumference has a straight path to the center, right? That's like a metaphor for wherever you are, there is your distinct way to attain. What you don't hear about is people saying, well, it's a complementary truth. From the center, there's equal access to all points on the circumference. From the center of yourself, you have equal access to all possibilities. A lot of the techniques of the great work have to do with equilibration and training aspects of yourself that are weak and purifying them and so forth. But this isn't so that everybody comes out the same, or everybody comes out like some homogenized cookie cutter kind of thing. It's the goal of everybody having equal access to all possibilities. That comes from the center. You don't know until you get there what you need. Train in everything, and you have access to anything. I'm going to skip the whole module on nested centers. Speak of all of these arrows in us flying off in all these directions from our thoughts and interests and distractions and what's pulling us. Life is complicated, right? It's getting more complicated. How many electronic devices did you bring on this trip?
I lost count.
Okay. I know I've got four.
I got up.
Okay. So two of us coming have over half a dozen separate electronic devices that do slight variations of the same thing in different sizes and forms and things like that. That's just one example. You know, what was it? There are currently, last time I got a figure from someone, there's something like 21 separate foreign nationalist religious groups that want to kill you. I can't bother to keep up with that. There's lots of data, lots of facts. Wow, you know, more on the internet in a few seconds than you can find by going through the whole library when you were a kid. Well, those of you who are older than 15. The point here is that complexity is easier to manage when you are authentically simple. When you consciously conform to the simple, elegant truth of your essential being has a simple, elegant truth to it. It is everything in your world and yet is simple. It is elegant in the mathematical sense. And when you attune to that, life gets simpler. Complexity resolves itself. This is a good break before I go to the other topic, and we've been at this most of an hour, so why don't we take a 5-minute stretch down the hall, whatever you need to do, and then I hope you're all planning to come back, because it's going to get glitter. Okay, the... The method of science, the aim of religion. The method of science is call a 5-minute break knowing it will take 10. The aim of religion is pray it doesn't take 15. By the way, does anybody here like wine? Nobody?
Does anyone do what? I didn't hear you.
Does anybody like wine?
Wine? Of course.
It makes me really angry.
Just as a bit of fun, on the way...
Doesn't like me.
Okay. On the way to an event at Block, Marion and I have started a project called Wizards of Wine. It's basically a sharing of our wine journey. Eventually, it's going to be a blog. I'm going to get that started out, but right now it's on Facebook. But if you go to singular wizardofwine.org, it will forward you to the Facebook page. So, come on. I mention that right now because the art of appreciating wine is like the art of living. Okay? There's an approach to life that people mostly understand if they understand what it is to appreciate wine. Okay? I mean, it's more than going dark berry, mostly blackberry, it's got a chocolate edge, and if you really let an air of it, it starts to get a strange floral off, which is unusual for a Chilean Cabernet this young. And the tannins are almost Napa-esque. Aside from that, it's about that kind of analysis is not about sounding cool. That kind of analysis is not about memorizing a bunch of things. It's about the ability to hone your senses, to minutely attend to things, and the practice, point the circle, the practice both of seeing the trees and the forest. The practice of going through life, witnessing each minute thing, and taking in the whole. Their experiences in his commentary on the Book of the Law, Crowley speaks to as continual weddings with Nui. You as a hadith, as a point of view, your point of view, that's where I'm going, that's what I'm going to say. Your point of view, and in your entire passage, your real job is to view, to perceive, to witness every aspect. Because everything around is the body of Nui. And with each thing that you have a deep connection, with each thing you witness closely, like the extreme would be each thing you have samadhi on, right? The thing you pay close attention to, that's union with Nui. That's a sexual act with the infinite. Or warm up. Anyway, thanks to whoever brought the Chilean cat.
That was, man.
Sir Michael.
Let's give it up.
I'll be loud later.
Anyway, we're having a lot of fun with it. There's a phrase. I mean, do what the world is amazing. Four words to say so much. But you know, you gotta admit it takes a certain amount of orientation to get it right. Have some idea of what's being talked about. A certain amount of introduction. There's a phrase, I don't know where it originated, but in the 1930s, it caught on to some pockets of the astrological community, especially West Coast, and eventually flourished. I ran into it in many places. Late Sid Dobbins made it a hallmark of her work and her teaching. And in three words, character is destiny. Character is destiny. This phrase offers a comprehensible way to cut to most of the meanings we imply by do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. All of it. Character has both a being and a doing aspect. So in practice, what I would say is how your life unfolds, what appears to be your destiny, what appears to be the phenomenology of your life, is consequence of who you are and what you do in terms of the choices you make. Right? Most people are going to quickly, intuitively catch on to the phrase, character is destiny, and run with it and just say, one little explanation that has both a being and a doing aspect. Who you inherently are and what you do in terms of choices you make determines the path of your life. It can have deeper levels. You can run this whole thing through the four worlds. You can take it. I am not at all interested in doing away with do at the world, but it occurs to me, and something I have started to speak for the temples of our order about, is I want to encourage the ongoing use and the awareness of the simple idea, character is destiny. Make it a secondary call phrase, because I think it puts it right in front of you, puts your choices right in front of you. Events arise out of who you are and the choices you make, especially the choices regarding whether to conform authentically to your essential nature, to be yourself, versus not to be. Again, that's a mindfulness practice of karma yoga. So much of the pain-pleasure ratio comes not from willpower, but from willpower. It comes from fighting the truth about ourselves, from getting in the way, basically of trying to swim upstream, but more like having the stream pushing inside of you, straining against you, because you won't flow with the current of who you are. Events arise out of who you are and the choices you make, and the actions dependent upon those choices, especially those choices concerning whether to be authentic and true to yourself or whether to act at odds with that. You've probably heard all of your life things about making choices. You've probably heard all of your life until the point where it's easy to just make this a parental nag rather than the key to your unlimited power. You know, the damnable thing about having somebody we don't want to listen to tell us the truth is we don't listen to it. Now, of course, if character is destiny, there's the eternal question, why do bad things happen to good people? Right? If character is destiny, why do bad things happen to good people? It's because they're not real people. It's because they're untrue to themselves. They're not true people. It's not about being good. Being good is about following some particular code that somebody else wrote. And that may or may not be true to you. Most of you know this. Most of you also know that all morality is relative. Now, society's only gotten this far because people wrote what they presented as universal codes, and it is amazing how much the universal codes of different religions and so forth have in common across time. Like, they all say, don't kill. And you know what? In our society, essentially everybody has that one integrated. You know, are we fundamentally brutes and violent underneath? Okay, we're animals. On the other hand, culturally and in our mass mind, we have accepted in mass collection, don't kill. Right? On the other hand, we know there are exceptions. And you've all been in these debates and heard these debates. You know, like, oh, what are the times when you would kill? Is it okay to kill here? But notice those are treated as exceptions. The broad species adoption, the broad species agreement, if you don't kill. And then we recognize that something as fundamental as this, sometimes you have to make a decision at the spot. In other words, even that single most common, single most universal moral item is relativistic. In fact, all morality is relativistic. You know, we learn by hard rules until we take over. You know how it goes. It's like, when you're really little, you're carried across the street. When you're a little older, it's, now don't cross the street unless mommy or daddy has your hand and is going with you. Eventually you graduate to, so you stand there and you look at the light, and when the light turns green, or when the, my bad ethnic joke, well, we only get to move when white man says walk. Anyway, the people remember that. when the walk sign is there, when the green sign, whatever it is in the neighborhood, you only go, yeah, we come up to rules. Only cross the street when the light is green, and then look both ways and be sure there aren't any cars coming, and pay attention as you go across, right? You know, like we move up from being carried to being accompanied to having a rule to follow. There comes a time in everyone's life when you're standing at a red light for 5 minutes. Nothing's coming all night across that street, and you make the choice to cross anyway. Right? You make a relativistic judgment based on the rule. And all morality is there. You can't know, we all inherently know what's right or wrong. We have an inherent truth sense. We can listen to ourselves. But you can't know what's right or wrong unless you're standing there. Unless you're at that spot, in that situation, at that moment in time. Now, the codes can help. The codes can help us get there. The codes can help us weigh decisions. But ultimately, you never know what's right from a code. You only know what's right from being there in the moment. There are people who hate that. There's a Christian author, actually a radical Christian author, some of you may know, named John Middleton Murray, editor, did some astounding stuff. Here's a quote from him. It's a little hard to listen to, so I'll go slowly, but it's an amazing quote. For a good man to realize that it is better to be whole than to be good. Better to be whole than to be good. Is to enter on a straight and narrow path of rectitude compared to which his previous rectitude was flowery license. Mm. The rightness, the morality of knowing and acting in accordance with the idea that to be whole is better than to be good is a high, high ethic. The thing is, you need to listen to the situation. You need to be there. Oh, wait, you need to be there. Don't just be passing through, be there. Whatever the moment, whatever the situation, consciously, mindfully, like you're tasting wine, be there. You need to listen to your life. Your life is always communicating. Things happen, right? Your life is always communicating. You can call it God, you can call it the Holy Guardian Angel, you can call it some higher aspect of yourself, you can call it some universe, I don't care what you call it. Life talks to you continuously, and your life talks to you continuously. And life is always pragmatic. It's not idealistic. Life doesn't, you have ideals, and please continue to have them. Set your ideals, pick them. Live in accordance with them. Edit them as you find you need to. But life is completely pragmatic, and you need to be pragmatic in your response to what your life is saying. There are options presented in fact. Which one do you pick? Which one do you pick? The Book of Law tells us that our will must be without lust of result. What's that mean? Actually, it's a core idea of karma yoga. The idea of karma yoga is work without attachment to work. Do without attachment to the consequences or results of the doing. Plant a tree that you'll never see develop fruit. Your will must be without lust of result, unencumbered by mental or emotional stubbornness on the matter. Your will must be unencumbered by your mental or emotional stubbornness on what should be. On the way to success, people get stuck between damn it, I know what I want, and I won't take no for an answer on the one hand, and I guess I'm not going to get it, I might as well give up on my dreams. You know, people don't want to be wrong, people get tired of failing, and, you know, it's like, you know, I've done all the correct visualization, the magic spells, or acted like I was told to act, or you got to follow the, you know, it's not working out. People get stuck between the issue of wanting something with all their heart, thinking they have to give up on it because it's not here now. That's not a dichotomy. People mix up. I mean, excuse me, time's a fucker. People screw up the meaning of past, present, and future. You have to make all your decisions in the present. On the way to success, on the way to success, people get stuck between that polarity. It's a false dichotomy. There is no, this is the single most important thing I would tell you all day. Okay? If you take this, understand it, and run with this, this will transform your life. There is no inherent dichotomy, no inherent conflict between the reality you want and the different reality presently in front of you. There is, huh?
I said, oh my God.
There is,
after like 5 minutes.
There is no conflict to walking to 30th Street just because at the moment you find yourself at 24th. Right? There is no conflict between walking to 32nd Street and looking up and seeing you're at 24th. You're still walking to 30th Street. Right?
No, I don't accept
24th Street. I'm on 30th Street. Why is the 30th Street there? Come on. Come on. I guess I have to give up on my hope, my dream of 30th Street. Let alone 42nd. You know? But think of your life as walking down the street. You are in motion. There is no inherent conflict between the reality you want and the reality present in front of you. You wouldn't be picking the future and expect to find it in the present. Okay? The visualizing the future you want should have nothing to do with... What I see a lot of people doing is they go, okay, I'm visualizing this thing, I'm hoping for this thing, I'm working for this thing, and I just don't have it. I just don't get it. You know, it's like, it's not here. It looks like I'm wandering far out. Sometimes you have to take a detour. You know, your life takes detours. Okay? The thing is, okay, I'll do that module. So many people think they're driven by their past. They're formed by their past. Okay? That the past made you what you are. That it's all the stuff that came up to now. The past is what you have to own, is the only thing you have because you've been there. The past only determines who you are now if you stay attached to it. Right? You can hold on to it. You can live there. Does anyone here remember the first episode of Deep Space Nine? Any chance? Okay? They kept flashing him back to this emotionally traumatic scene in his life. And they said, why are you taking me there? They go, what are you talking about? You're living there. You know how you emotionally live in an old moment? Right? These time-independent beings weren't taking him to this traumatic moment to relive. He'd never stop living it. Right? And that's where people are who have a lot of pain, and that's how we all are to a certain extent. I have profound respect for the history and the current culture and what they have given us of the Jewish people as a whole. But always remember sucks, and is the worst piece of advice in the history of the world. Always live in the past and don't let go of it is the worst piece of advice in the history of the world. What determines your present is your future. Why are you on 24th Street at the moment? It's because you're walking to 30th. Right? It's the only reason you look up and find that you're at 6th and 24th. Because you're walking up 6th Avenue to 30th. It's your future that's determining your present. Right? It's where you're going that leads you there. That's the reason that the technique of visualization never includes the means. Does the end justify the means? No, they are unrelated to each other. Okay? It's like, you don't say, I want to have this and this and this happen so I can get that. No, you say, I want to get to that. You let your life get you there. Like the best GPS system was you may be picking whether you're going to take the scenic route or the most direct route. And whether you're going to navigate around detours and traffic jams, right? You pick the end result and that leads you. This is where the ideals come in. This is where selection and choice come in. You pick your future. Where are you going? What are you about? What do you see yourself in the most unfolded state? What do you see? And you pick that. And you keep that in mind, and that determines your present. That defines who you are now. You are not the person who had XYZ history. You're the person who's going to ABC. Right? That's your present. So, besides, everyone always forgets history and trying to get them to remember it just doesn't work. There is no inherent conflict between the reality you want and the reality presently in front of you because you're still en route. The real breakthrough is in truly understanding that these are quite separate things. And therefore, so what I see people doing is they resist their present. They go, this isn't what I want. You know, they push it aside, they don't notice it, they try to go in denial about it. No, it's that thing I said about tasting wine as a model for how to live life. Totally, completely embrace and accept your present at every step of the way. For one thing, it doesn't do you any good not to. You know, you want to be totally pragmatic, it doesn't change the present because you deny it. Right? It doesn't make the thing you don't like go away. Denying it, ignoring it reduces your power. Because the only way you have power over anything or are powerful in a moment is when you actually get the reality of what's there. When you actually have a relationship to the circumstances. So to deny or resist the actual current circumstances is to give up power to alter them to the extent that you do it. So there are two things that are there. One is hold passionately to where you're going and embrace passionately what's now, what's here. That will so connect you to stuff. That will so connect you to stuff. Life as a wine tasting.
That's good.
Okay?
That's good. I love the Shiraz, but really, I plan on having it happen.
Right.
I looked for the Shiraz, I couldn't find any, so. I'm serious, it's not a metaphor, I really did that.
He's a Shiraz guy, yeah.
Yes, I am.
So the real breakthrough is understanding these things are totally different. To live life being clear and conscious of what you choose and accepting without resistance what is before you is to live a life of will without lust of result. You're neither giving up on the goal nor concerned that it's not here at the moment. It's the technique of living life without lust of result, of will without lust of result. So here's a technique. At each juncture, each time you have to like stop and think and make a decision of the sort, look out upon the panorama of your life. I stole this quote from David Brooks, who was writing about the political process, and he was concerned, he was discussing political idealists versus political pragmatists. You know, those who will only get stuck on the ideal they want and, you know, a party-centric kind of thing, versus those who actually get in there and figure out what's needed and start producing it. So I stole that, but it applies back. At each juncture, look out upon the panorama of your life and ask yourself, given the correlation of forces, the convergence of vectors, my turn, correlation of all the things that are existing there in your life, before you here and now, what is the landscape offering me? What is the landscape offering me? And then always order off the menu. That's me. And then always order off the menu. Speaking of quotes, a lot of you know that I highly praise a book by a Quaker philosopher named Parker Palmer called Let Your Life Speak. This is a book I wish I'd written. It says essentially everything that I kind of hope to eventually get into an instruction on discovering in your true will and living in conformity with it. I never got around to writing it again. I'm enormously grateful because, you know, that's just another me, right? Let Your Life Speak, Listening to the Voice of Vocation by Parker J. Palmer. The hardcover is not very expensive. I recommend it. I want to read you a few quotes that really move me, that I think are important. Some of you heard these before. I use them often. Before you tell your life what you intend to do with it, listen to what it intends to do with you. Listen to your life. Before you tell your life what truths and values you've decided to live up to, let your life tell you what truths you embody, what values you distinctly, uniquely represent. Listen to your life. Another quote. True self, when violated, will always resist us. We can say true will, when violated, will always fight us. Sometimes at great cost, holding our lives in check until we honor its truth. Continue to resist truth about yourself, that can result in paralysis. It can result in hospitalization. It can result in very strange adventures. The attempt to live by the reality of our own nature, which means our limits as well as our potentials. Live by the reality of our own nature, which means our limits as well as our potentials, is a profoundly moral regimen. Which is a long way of saying, do what thou wilt should be the whole of the law. One dwells with God by being faithful to one's nature. I love seeing him say that. One crosses God by trying to be something one is not. Reality, including one's own reality, is divine, to be not defied but honored. I like this quote. Where the Book of Law tells us there's division hither homeward, Palmer speaks, he's got a long section on the process of finding the courage to live divided against ourselves no more. Stop living divided against ourselves. And he understands that the way to God is down, that is down into the depths of ourselves, and it's found only by embracing all aspects of what's found without judgment. Oh, I got my good things and my bad things, and I don't want people to know about my bad things, and I don't really want to know about my bad things. But first of all, when did you make the decision those were your bad things? Teaching is own it all. One, you don't have power unless you own it all. Two, things you deny is energy of your psyche, a whole part of your psyche that you're binding up and denying. Plus, you're taking more energy to hide it. I mean, you're really compounding this absorption of your energy. So, when things don't work right, What about restriction? That's, according to the book of the law, that's the only sin that there is. Implicitly, self-restriction, self-denial, resistfulness. But, you know, it's like we encounter environmental restriction. Like, you know, doesn't seem to be working. Ordeals are part of the work. If somebody takes initiation in Temple of Thelema and doesn't have any life ordeals, they should be profoundly disappointed. Because what we especially do is add energy to the whole psyche. That's like, and sometimes that's like checking the alignment of your wheels by gunning the engine on a straightaway. You get to real fast find out whether it leans left or right, and whether you need to take it into the shop. Kind of the same thing true with you. Ordeals are our teacher. They point out where we need to learn something. By the way, about painful ordeals, it's only our reaction that makes them painful. Other than pure physical pain, you know, other than physical damage, there is nothing inherently painful in any life experience. There is nothing inherently painful in any life experience unless there's physical pain involved. It's totally our reaction to it. That means it's something under our control. Pain is a mark of resistance. Pain is a result of the scarring and the pain of denying what's true of us in our circumstances. Now, there are reasons that we go into denying, suppressing that, not wanting that, accepting the pain instead of owning the situation. Some situations are just things that at one point in time we can't face up to. We need to move past, we need to let time heal it. It's strange. The brain isn't wired to remember physical pain. The brain will remember times you felt physical pain, remember your reaction to it, but the brain isn't capable of storing a memory of physical pain. All the stored pain is emotion. That means it's subject to a decision. We make decisions at any given point in time based upon the best we can do. We make decisions at 4 years old about how to deal with great big people who we have some kind of experience with, whatever the range of it is. We make decisions about how to make mom happy, how to get her goat. You know, we make all these decisions. The thing is, we're not wired. They don't have a timeout. So basically, you continue going through your life acting on the same decision until you make a point of stopping and making a new decision about it. Frankly, at this point in your life, you could all do better than a four-year-old. But I can guarantee that you all have decisions you made at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 that are still running your life. This is what I like to call letting your life decisions be made by a four-year-old. Right? Think about it! Would you turn over all your important life decisions and your day-to-day things to a four-year-old? But unless you re-decide certain decisions you made, certain basics that you accepted, certain definitions you put in place, certain defenses that you put in place, that's what you're doing. I'm not Pollyanna here, but while I don't wish pain on anyone, I will tell you that our response to someone who encounters pain in the order is to also look for how pain can ennoble us and strengthen us, to be compassionate, and to keep pointing out that pain is a communication. Pain is a communication. Are you listening? It's never an idle communication. Communication. Ordeals are angelic breadcrumbs in lead us through the woods. Through the woods. Not to avoid the woods. Through the woods. Restriction, barriers, encounters are definition. You know, as I approach my second Saturn return, one of the things I remember from the first is realizing that when Saturn comes back around again to face its natal place, that means seeing how you have structured, defined, and limited things coming back to stare you in the face. You encounter the things that are the results of your own definitions, of your own limitations, of your own narrownesses. That's what you're facing. Restriction is definition. Definitions you hold and periodically need to outgrow. To learn who we are, we must also learn who we aren't. You know, there are big meditations about, I'm not that, I'm not that, I'm not that. Hitting barriers in life teaches you that. Not that. Walk around. Life provides this instruction. Life provides instructions in who we are by doors closing behind us. Doors closing behind us. Chapters ending. Things walked away from. Life teaching us who we aren't. Times of loss can be times of the most enormous clarity and freeing energy. You know, there's a thing about death. Somebody close to you dies. When we get close to someone, we invest part of ourselves in them. We give part of ourselves. We exchange energy. Right? They comes and goes. Part of us resides in them. Part of them is here in us. When they cease on this plane to exist, all that energy that we've invested is not ever separated from us. We've been there with them. Everything we've invested snaps back like a rubber band and floods into us all at once. What's that wave of emotion? You know, the more powerful somebody was in your life, it's everything of you that you'd invested in that person coming back. And by the way, usually bringing something of them with it. Like I say, someone you're close to always leaves you an inheritance. It's something of them that now resides in you. But this energy comes back, and what happens is we become overwhelmed, and it's a wave, and there's grief, and there's tears, and we run it off, and that's natural. If you can get that it's energy surging in, that all that feeling is all of this energy coming in, you can essentially waste it, which is what we reflexively do. We reflexively waste it by burning it off. Or you can say, I'm feeling this, it's here, it's coming, what do I want to invest in it? You can reinvest your investment. You can invest into something that matters to the two of you together, something that matters to them, something entirely new in your life. It can be something flooding back from them that suddenly frees you. We don't like to admit that. Frees you to suddenly go a new direction. And part of that's because you have all this enormous new energy, all this new creative power, all this new power of choice, all this power of execution flooding back into you. That's the power of separation. That's the power of what we normally take as the pain of separation. Everything you had invested in them flowing back to you, fortified and new. What are you going to do about it? Can you be conscious about it at the time? Alchemy talks about turning lead into gold. And at the time these metaphors came, Saturn was the outermost planet known. Saturn's lead. It was the circumference of the solar system. Okay? The sun is gold. It's the center of the solar system. Turning lead into gold is taking the Saturn-like encounters and experiences of the circumference, the outermost, and surging them in, fortified to come alive in the center. Okay? It's a circumference to center kind of thing from a Saturn to solar kind of model. Lead to gold. Woo! We have a little over another hour here. I don't have that much to go, but I'm in a place where now I want to go headlong into a summary and restatement. Some new stuff. So I think, based upon the old preacher's metaphor, that the mind can only absorb what the ass can stand. Maybe we're another five. Let's take another five.
Awesome.
Let's target being back in our seats on our own at 5 o'clock.
Yes.
Take five. Okay. A little bit of recognition, a little bit of summary, a little bit of couldn't resist putting some new things in. Probably then and we'll have time for some Q&A and some time to eat and drink. Okay? Does that work?
Yeah.
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 Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay.
Enthusiasm.
As you can tell, some of the things, I like the way I wrote them in advance and some things I just thought. Let's see where this goes. If you're looking for a set of principles by which to live a spiritual life, one that inherently draws you more deeply toward your spiritual goals simply in the course of living your life, even without having to do anything else particular, but simply in the course of living your life, one great challenge is in the artificiality of the generic moral codes that have been provided by all the religions. Now, there's nothing inherently wrong with any particular premise in any of them. There are many people for whom each particular premise is pure gold. The only error in any of them is that morality is inherently relative. Morality in terms of what's right or wrong, or what choice you're going to make along that kind of thing, you can only know when you're standing there. You can only make that decision when you're in the spot where the decision point occurs. Right versus wrong choices must be made anew by each person in each situation in a way that is authentic to themselves and true to the conditions of the moment. True to the conditions of the time and the place. My religion teaches me, choose ye an island. In the great ocean of possibility, pick the place that will be your spot of dry land. In all the range of the universe, pick the one place you will take your stand. Stand there and take your stand. Find your inner truth and stand up. Stand for it. In the way that perhaps you have witnessed that I am standing for each and every one of you knowing and doing your true will as a central kernel to your life. Stand on it and for it with the concurrent acknowledgement that each person gets their own island. Oh yeah, the more islands we have, the more wars we have, right? Unless you acknowledge each person's entitled to their own island. Every member of Temple of Thelema. Every member of Temple of Flame is pledged to know and do their true will and to affirm the absolute right of everyone else to do their true will and respect this by our actions. You can't just say, this is all about me, just like fucking take it all I want, you know? Kick the low men in the gutter and kick the low women deeper in the gutter and, you know, no. If you're relying on a principle of reality that says you have unconditional right to fulfill that which you inherently are in a creative and dynamic way, there must be a universal law. It requires both the commitment, the promise to the universe that you will know and do your true will and that you will not just pass over there, but you will affirm by your actions the right of every other being to do theirs and conduct yourself accordingly. I would propose, while you're sorting through it, I would propose one moral standard. One moral standard as the only universal non-relative standard for all. That you strive to know yourself deeply, and at each step of the process, act authentic to that self. Thou hast no right but one right to do thy will. And express that passionately, and express it with enthusiasm, and express it with conviction and express it with confidence, and in all of that, respect by your thoughts and words and deeds, by your thoughts and your words and your deeds, everybody else's right to the same. To me, that's the whole thing. And it's all there in that one line, thou hast no right but to do thy will, as a starting point, not as an end result, as your this minute starting point. Doing your true will, I'm going to walk up the elements. Doing your true will based on true knowledge of that will, confirmed in the sanctuary of your heart, is the foundation of Thelemic life and the key to Thelemic spiritual practice. Doing your will in full knowledge of that will, confirmed in the sanctuary of your heart, is the foundation of Thelemic life and the key to Thelemic spiritual practice. Living true to who you are is an entire curriculum of attainment. It is karma yoga. Ooh, I'm fine. This is easily understood by the phrase character's destiny, which I encourage you to take viral. Your life is determined by who you are and by how you act, based on choices you make, conscious or unconscious. By the way, it's a well-established fact, in case of a conflict, unconscious wins over conscious. Okay? Now, subconsciousness is amenable to any suggestion by the conscious mind if it's more than an idle thought, if it's like with conviction of who you are and certainty. So subconscious mind will take up any suggestion. You know, the usual contrast is like, you can give it all the messages, quit smoking, but if you keep buying a pack just in case, that's the message subconsciousness is going to run with. Right? Okay? So it has to demonstrate it by your actions, take it in and hold it with conviction, and subconsciousness will take, it will let you write on its surface with the with the stylus of your conscious mind. But in case there are motives there that you are simply in denial of, or resisting, or actually even just unaware of, they win. That's where all the power is. Okay? Gotta get clean with yourself for a successful life. Doing your true will is the starting line, not the finish line. It is the method. But how many runners here? Let us note the actuality of the times. So, but it doesn't start at the starting line, does it? No. There's all sorts of stuff we have to do to get to the starting line. So how do we get to the starting line? I've given you a lot of specific teachings. I've given you a lot of concrete, specific recommendations. They should enable you to unfold the self-knowledge to yourself simply in the course of living your life, even if you did nothing else. Karma yoga is the traditional practice of a, what would the term be? Of a lay devotee in the course of living their life rather than, say, a monastic or wholly dedicated devotee. We can all use it. Giving you many clues that will work that way. We also have a training method. You know, this is going to be a commercial, but it's in your service. We also have a training method and a community of people pursuing the same goals with the same methods. Qabalah Thelema's main goal is to train all to know and do their true will. I am very proud of the New York Temple. If you are so inclined and interested, our practice is to announce who we are and our availability. And you're introduced to the chiefs if they raise their hands. And no pressure at all if anyone else who's a member wants to raise their hand.
I'm proud. I'm a member.
The membership is private, owned by the person. If you have any interest, if this actually sparks, like, this is the kind of thing that might actually work in your life, or be of some interest, talk to some of them while we move on soon to snacks and drink. That's what I had to say tonight. And I thank you all for coming out and being so generous. Okay. Now I'm going to give a speech about collecting for the Broadway AIDS Fund. thank you. We got a little time for questions, if there are any, and then we'll make yes, sir.
You spoke earlier in the during the lecture about people hiding things about about ourselves from others, and consequently from ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
As an initiate, I have an obligation to keep certain things secret from non-initiates. As a loner, I value my privacy.
Yes.
I tend to, if there are people I don't connect with, I tend to keep them at arm's length.
Mm-hmm.
How do you distinguish between privacy and silence versus hiding shit about yourself?
Outstanding question.
Wait, hold on.
Very good question.
Because everybody said it was outstanding, I didn't actually hear
it. Okay. The question was, since I had said that I'd spoken to disclosing yourself as a way of being alive and not hiding yourself from others as a way of not hiding
right.
yourself. He said that as an initiate, he has obligations to secrecy. As a private practitioner, he values his privacy. There are some people he chooses just not to show anything off to. These are all interesting scenarios. The one in terms of shared confidences, okay? The one in terms of you enter a group and you promise to keep private things private. And that includes things like people's membership and things like this. It's their privacy. My standard response, which I believe is true response, is these are other people's secrets. Okay? Whatever it is to me, I owe a duty to other people and to my word to keep their private things private. Okay? So first of all, that's different from withholding yourself when you're honoring an honorable pledge and honoring duties to other people for their legitimate privacy. In terms of your own private stuff for people you just don't want to share it with, I think it all comes down to this. We build behavior by practice, by repetition. Okay? And continuing to repeat a long-term pattern of hiding yourself from others reinforces that. And the other extreme would create, would build another pattern in you. It would change your cells, it would change the wiring of your brain, it would change your reflexes. When we want to change a habit, sometimes, this isn't a prescription, this is just how neurology works, sometimes we have to go a little overboard because you need to overcome old habits with different behaviors, right? It's a balance in here. I guess the underlying principle is, can you find the places in your life to be disclosing of who you are and actively practice that? Okay? Actively practice that to build new behaviors and new habits. In the absence of that, this is one of the great services of the magical diary. There are better choices out in the real world, but if you have no other choice, the diary we relate to as if it's another, as if it's someone else. And in the act of practicing complete disclosure to the diary, we get some measure of the practice. We get to witness what we're holding back in ourselves. We get, you know, things of that sort. And so that's a kind of last thing. If you're in a group that of people with whom you share secrets, that might be, you know, that's going to be set aside as a different environment, a different social environment than the world at large. And so that's a place to practice safely your self-disclosure, perhaps, and practice with a select group, and practice it actively. That, you know, that's where you have to overcompensate for old habits by actively developing new ones. So those are some ideas, perhaps. Okay?
On that note, the exact opposite. What if somebody, like myself, who tends to blurt things out often? And so
things about you or things about other people?
Opinions, thoughts, in fact, I don't know most of the things that are happening. No, what I mean is, no, it's just on this, the exact opposite of, I'm working on my own personal practice of sucking in my words
okay. Before
I actually say them. And one of the things I came across last night in my own practice is the question of even writing.
Mm-hmm.
It out, letting it come out when it's written, because I kept journals ever since I was about 6 years old. And
you're used to that.
And I'm used to that, exactly.
Okay.
And I actually burnt all my journals this past spring, since my childhood. And I did that partially because when I looked at them, all I saw was the same things over and over.
Okay.
So I'm just wondering, like,
you want to free yourself from your past. That's a powerful thing to do.
Well, yeah. So on that note of maintaining, how to have that practice going,
okay.
and then be able to have the key to be able to go through the thoughts and not have them be all.
Got it. Okay. So we all need balance in whatever extreme we are. You're just the rarer extreme of that continuum. Okay. You're rare stuff. or maybe not. I'll get there. Okay, so first of all, it's certainly valuable to learn to control your use of words. Okay, that's just a discipline. Like any other action, to be sufficiently mindful. It's a powerful and important practice to be mindful of what you were saying and whether you really intend to communicate anything by it. Okay? Because a lot of communication has no intention behind it. People don't get that, hey, I'm entitled to say what I want to say, and it's my free speech, and it's my self-expression, and so if you don't understand it, you know where it goes from there, right? The thing is, that's true if my goal is basically an artistic goal of giving an expression, right? And it's true if my purpose is to communicate, then it's not true that it's on the other person whether they understand me. It's on me whether I communicate in a way that they will understand. Right? And so that increases your effectiveness a whole lot. And just the practice, the spiritual practice of mindfulness of your words and of intention behind them, and of your goal, and whether you intend to communicate. Or sometimes whether you tend to use it as camouflage. It's okay to use your words for camouflage, but coming from the starting point you told me, it's a powerful practice to actually know whether that's what you're doing, rather than go on habit. Okay? And so having said all of that, and answering the general question and not pointing this at you particularly,
mm-hmm.
For somebody who talks all the time about anything, there's always the question of whether that's actually withholding themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Actually withholding
themselves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The words come out, but do we ever get to see the person?
Yeah.
And I can't answer that. I'm just saying that's another thing to look at.
Sure.
By removing the camouflage, well, it's good practice to do all those things. By removing the camouflage, do we get the chance to actually see the person? that we didn't get to see before. Mary had a question.
Well, I think there, well, I want to add on that, and then I had a question, but I don't want to take away from. But I think there's a distinction of you can be disclosing of yourself and hold true to your secrets and other people's secrets. They actually are separate, and it's a useful muscle to develop. And sometimes the best way to keep a secret, because I practice it regularly, is to be a fully disclosing type person, and people don't think you are hiding anything.
True.
And you actually are. Yeah, people have secrets, you know, they don't.
It's good.
This might go along again with the hiding of the self. It's, I jokingly said to my husband that I still reserve the right to lie to undercovers and doctors.
Of course!
So I guess it's like, yeah, of course. I mean, you know, some people, whether it's their job or whether they're just that way.
Right.
Being too open and honest with them, they're looking for something they can use against you, and sometimes it might be discerning.
I have always held that it's appropriate to lie about something that's nobody's business or where declining to answer would answer. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So the almost everyone I know has been busted on a drug charge. It happened because they sold to a cop. And so, you know, I think it's righteous. I don't think cops should have drugs sold to them. You know, think about it. While on duty? Yeah, somebody sold cops drugs on duty.
I wanted to go back to True Will for a second because, for example, I was a mortgage broker for like 20 years. I was very, very successful at it before the market collapsed. Mm-hmm. And I was also a mom. I am a mom. So, you know, there's 3-4 different hats that I could very easily put on under the whole guise of success is your proof. So picking one or picking all, is there a juggling act that you can do?
Don't confuse true will with your job. Okay? If you have, whether it's on that basis or some other basis, if you get down to 4 or 5 truths about you, the same can be different truths. You can just hold that at the moment. But basically, the question to ask is, what's behind, what commonality is behind all of those things? Right? It's like, if I was interested in psychology and psychometric testing and astrology and several other subjects. Well, just at that point, those have in common ways of discerning and understanding character patterns in a particular person, right? So I picked an easy one here. In more complicated things, it's like, I'm certain there's one thing you were doing behind each of those. Okay? And that one thing is what they all do, and from that one thing, there are all kinds of expressions of it, right? And it can be expressed as a mortgage broker, just. Aside from the fact that we take wrong turns, let's assume there was, those were all right turns. Or left turns. Those are all viable expressions. I mean, so if I'm here to train all to know to do their true will, why am I wasting my time on a wine call? Most of you know. It's a tool for training people to know to do their true will. Okay. Let's swing to the other side of the room.
I have another question about why good things happen. I mean, bad things happen to good people.
They titled the famous book that I stole, yes.
Right.
Not the book. Right.
But okay, so then there's, okay, you're saying, okay, they're not being real people. But then there's certain, those things where, okay, they're a good person and a bad thing happens and then they find something. They find a negative
hole in that. True. Yes, it can be instruction.
So it's not necessarily that they were not real, right?
I could give you a technically out answer that showed that I was right. But they basically yes, that's true, and let's just leave it like that. Right, well part I was saying is not being fully connected to the truth is part of being untrue.
I see.
Okay? It doesn't mean you're lying.
Right.
It means you may be ignorant of it.
Right?
Something needs to wake
right.
you up to it.
Does it mean that you're not connected to yourself, though? Is that what you're ultimately saying? Like, you're not connected to your true self, and that's why you're being unauthentic?
You're being consciously or unconsciously inauthentic, yes.
Inauthentic, and...
You're
that's when bad stuff happens, is when we're inauthentic, then?
Yeah, you know, when you're... If you're not an off-road vehicle and you start heading across the rocks, it's going to mess up your suspension because you're not the kind of vehicle that goes on that terrain.
Right.
Right.
Do you feel ever sometimes it's the opposite? People have bad things happen. I'm thinking of a 14-year-old girl in Afghanistan who was shot by the Taliban because she was trying to do her will, insisting on her right to get an education. It's like a bad thing that happened to someone for...
We could, okay, so first of all, let me admit that we could debate this with good, strong philosophical debate for weeks or months. That one I put in the category of the same kind of logic of civil disobedience. There's sometimes you have to do things with full knowledge of the consequences, with your eyes wide open, and accept the consequences. Because those are the conditions. Remember I said, look at the terrain and see what the terrain is offering you and order off the menu, okay? In her world, in her situation, what she wanted to order wasn't on the menu. So she ordered one thing that was on the menu, which was not her getting that education, but her taking a stand that would affect that for down the road for others. That's something that was available to order off the menu. And probably...
Well, that was a stand.
Yeah, that was a stand. Oh, it's ongoing.
Well, no, it was related. I mean, I was just saying that when you're talking about bad things, what kind of bad things are you... I mean, what's the distinction?
I just meant things that people call bad things.
Okay, because it almost to me seems like certain things, you know, it's almost tantamount to victim blaming to say that the person, you know, like, wasn't really being authentic. It's something extremely external, like a natural disaster or a sexual assault or something like that that really has nothing to do with them.
I hear that it seems like victims. So one, let me say, I gave this to each of you to look at your own lives for, not the label. And the other thing is, I really think we're much larger than what we normally think, and that we know everything. And that we are at places and do make choices at a much deeper level. I wasn't mostly taking the talk today there, but I do think that there's a deeper level. I mean, I'm just giving you my opinion there. But also, I didn't necessarily, you bring up a great point, because I didn't have in mind giving this to you as a way to judge other people's lives, as a way to look at your own, and to reflect on it, and to accept or reject it based upon things. And I know that some of the really tough stuff is hard on that. I just told somebody earlier, in my 20s, I was clinically trained for and worked for a time in the first grade response program that actually used men and women equally, and that was a long time ago. And so, I mean, I've lived there, and we were very acute about not assigning blame, and in fact, at that time of intervention, it wasn't even the time to talk about personal responsibility. It was a time to listen and draw it out and help connect back to life and things of that sort, because that's what was needed. I guess the advice I give there is careful about judgments, because unless they're about yourself, and then be careful about judgments.
Explain those situations where we've made the conscious decision to walk down the street and these series of events have occurred to us, whether it's like a gun getting pulled on us and some negative thing has happened. So did we, we're drawn toward this direction or the street, we've made that conscious choice. So is this something that was supposed to happen in our experience? And so
I wouldn't use the word supposed. Okay, so sometimes there are accidents. we screw up. Because that's I too. But they, but I do think that we are larger. I think we know almost everything. Okay? I think, you know, subconsciousness is the level at which we are all connected to each other. And it's the real World Wide Web. And along that, we're all connected. And something happening down here, somebody lying in wait, or some set of circumstances, that's communication to us. It's just not up in our conscious mind. And so the question is, where do we make the choice from? I think we know essentially everything. And then we make choices, and those choices take us through experiences.
Right, so we go down this street, and it's led us to that. You think it's like we've kind of known on a subconscious level that...
Yes.
That would
yes.
be what
yes.
would be the outcome, and it was like something that we
can
handle, or
yeah, or we perceive the kind of energy of it, or something like that. I
sometimes you gotta remember. So we align with that energy
that you're shrouding too.
The what?
Sometimes you gotta just chalk it up and remember that maybe the clues of someone else, like someone who rapes or pulls guns on someone, is shrouding too.
Were we in that same energy vibration, is what I'm saying, as that, like,
thing? I think we're all connected. It's like when there's a conversation. I do think. I don't think we make any such decision. You know, sometimes we make mistakes. Sometimes we make poor judgments, and we learn from them. Right? You guys are really amped up. Okay.
Like, in the situation I was talking about before, like, she was fighting for education. Well, she received education. It wasn't the education she desired, but, like, she wanted to fight against society, and then she learned what society's reaction was. She was educated in how her society receives that part.
I think she knew.
I was going to say, like, I'm sure, like, I mean, she just, like, go out one day and say, I want education, and they just shot her? Or was it, like, I'm pretty sure there
was,
like,
a
build-up.
She was speaking in a crowd on behalf of the
she's taking a stand. She was doing a Michael Valentine Smith.
What you were talking about with the past and pain, remembering,
yes.
There's a lot of psychomagical techniques or that would utilize that energy from a specific, you know, brain racing moment.
Okay.
And in that area between your personality of what you are or what you perceive yourself to be and some disorder that you may have that you want to exclude from your personality or your personal being, that area there, is it worth going into that? I feel you when you say, you know, go to the future, don't go to the past, but there are times when I feel like that reliving or re-energizing those periods are important.
Okay, well, yeah, okay, there are. There are. Okay, here's the thing. I said, don't let your present be defined by it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, actually, I don't think I even said that. I said most people let that define it, but you can let the future define your present. Okay. There are times it's important as a matter of study. There are different therapeutic work approaches to. There is the question, you know, when I say don't let the past define your present, sometimes it's easier said than done. It's like, how do you not let it define you? How do you not keep going back? Something like that. How do you not let something like that decide it? I think all of those experiences that keep drawing us back are experiences we resisted. Okay? Ones we fought and didn't get. The reason it holds us back isn't the event, it's our resistance to it. It's our refusal to truly experience the event. And so there is power, and there's effectiveness in re-experiencing the event in whole. But the other side is, you can also do this going forward, because anything that has that kind of hold on you will replicate itself in similar events, with similar emotional reactions now. And every time you move into those consciously and embrace them, then you erode that whole old store of stuff. Okay? You can actually go forward in your life, freeing yourself as you go. And some other approaches, part of it's a severity thing. It's like, you know, my view on psychotropics is, from a therapeutic point of view, is if necessary and for a short time, because really cognitive elements, you're working with the person, more conventional psychotherapy is there, but sometimes you just need to intervene. Sometimes you just need to come back here, right? And sometimes on really strong owning stuff, you have to take strong intervention kind of stuff. And there are hypnosis methods, there are talk therapy methods, there are... I am not in favor, unless the situation is so extreme that there is no other seeming thing, I'm still not generally in favor of anything that erases any part of the past.
I'm
not in favor of that at all. I think the element is you wholly owning all of yourself. Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay? So that's my opinion. Okay, more? Or shall I let you loose on the books and the candidate dry? Okay. Huh?
You
okay,
got
I see a hand here. I see a hand here. Okay. Are these our last two? Okay.
Why don't you let him go first?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay. To put it in short, when you talk about the only right we have, and then you elaborated on that, what you get down to ultimately, somewhere down the road, is rights in conflict.
That's true unless, okay, my philosophical view and what I see working out in practice, so this is a mixture of theory and practice, is that the universe is inherently orderly and there are no rights in conflict, but the universe, this is a philosophical point of view, that the only reason for collision is people not driving in their own lane. Okay? To the extent, so it's really selfish of me to want you all to go and do your true will, so you fucking start dramming in your own life. You know, it's a story of the woman. It's a story of the woman who was really worried because her blonde daughter was driving on the freeway for the first time today, and then mother got even scarier, more scared when she saw on the news that some idiot was going the wrong way in the wrong lane on the freeway. So she called her daughter on the cell phone and said, hey, can you call your... I need to put this in these days. Hey, can you call your cell phone while you're driving? But somebody's driving the wrong way on the freeway, Ron. She says, not just somebody, dozens of them. Okay? One of my favorite ones.
Blonde jokes.
Plain with blonde jokes. So they... So part of this is, we have a mucked up society, and we can take... The thing is, when somebody with confidence drives their own lane, other cars that don't know where they're going tend to get out of the way. Unless they're complete idiots, and sometimes they bump into you. But in a world where everybody's driving their own lane, in multiple dimensions and infinite combinations and so forth, there is no collision. There may be jousting. You know, there may be testing yourself against each other, there may be drag racing, you know, there may be these kind of competitions and seeming conflicts and so forth.
Yeah, but the King of France was killed accidentally jousting, and that's what made Nostradamus famous, because he predicted it.
That's true.
Well, if we're ending, I just wanted to thank everybody, and I wanted to point out that we're going to be having some more events coming up. We have a study group that meets on the fourth Saturday, and our next topic is going to be keeping a magical diary, and we'll talk about the purposes and techniques, and if people want to bring their own diaries with them and share your practices, as well as, you know, hear about suggestions and look at famous people's diaries. That's what we're going to do. We also have a group for women that meets at my apartment called Babylon Salon. We're going to be talking about sex magic next time. There's flyers over here. Also, Juan does a lovely ritual, the lamp of invisible light. He does once a month on the second Saturday. It's a Thelemic ritual, and it's really lovely and moving. So there are flyers for all these events. We have a meetup group and a Facebook group for these groups. You can sign up and get on the list or sign our mailing list here. And thank you for coming. And
thank you, Jim.
Thanks.
Thank you.